Thank you. full of surprises. I was surprised to know that I have to do announcements this morning. Well, I guess I don't have any announcements, so I welcome everyone to church this morning. Welcome the service, preaching by Greg Fluitt. We look forward to what Jesus has laid on your heart.
Well, good morning. It's good to be with you again, and we're going to begin our time in a moment of prayer. So let me lead you in prayer for our service this morning. Our Lord and God, we thank you for the opportunity to be here. Lord, this is just a great moment in a week in which we can just set aside all the busyness, all the things that we've got going on, the things that we're worried about, the decisions that have to be made. We can place that into your hands. And we can come here and just commune with you, sing praises, Lord, hear your word. And so, Lord, I pray that this time that we get to spend together will truly be a refreshing time for us, an inspiring time for us, a rejuvenating time, so that when we go out from here, we will have a renewed sense of energy and excitement for the week that lies ahead, but also a greater dependence and trust in you and your sovereignty and your care over each and every aspect of our lives. And so whatever may be weighing on our hearts and minds this morning, God, I pray that we'll just put that off to the side, that we'll leave it in your hands, Lord, that we'll be present here for this moment, Lord, and that we will be renewed in our trust of who you are and your grace and your mercy and your love to us. And we pray this in the mighty name of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. I'm going to ask you to rise for the call to worship. So shout for joy to the Lord, brothers and sisters in all the earth. Worship the Lord with gladness. Come before him with joyful songs. Know that the Lord is God. It is he who made us, and we are his. We are his people, the sheep of his pasture. And so enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise, and give thanks to him and praise his name. For the Lord is good, and his love endures forever. His faithfulness continues through all generations. So our Lord has called us to worship, and he now also greets us with these words. And so grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. And together God's people say, amen. Let's sing our opening song.
Fire in my heart. We're going to read the litany for you. We hope that you will read along in your minds, but we're going to be using our voices today. The tenets that come out of Reformation. Scripture alone. We believe that this holy scripture contains the will of God completely, and that everything one must believe to be saved is sufficiently taught in it.
We receive all these books and these only as holy and canonical for the regulating, founding, and establishing of our faith.
Grace alone. It is by grace you have been saved through faith. And this is not from yourselves, it is the gift of God.
Without my deserving it at all, out of sheer grace, God grants and credits to me the perfect satisfaction, righteousness, and holiness of Christ.
Faith alone. It is by grace you have been saved through faith. And this is not from yourselves, it is the gift of God.
All I need to do is to accept this gift of God with a believing heart.
Christ alone. The angel said to Joseph, give him the name Jesus, because he will save his people from their sins.
Jesus saves us from our sins. Salvation cannot be found in anyone else. It is futile to look for any salvation elsewhere.
To God alone be the glory. What is the chief end of man?
To glorify God and to enjoy him forever.
Let us then glorify God. Let us glorify God for the gifts of scripture, faith, grace, faith, and the Lord Jesus Christ himself.
So this morning, in our message, we're going to be talking about fear. We've talked about a variety of emotions the times that I've been here, doubt and fear. And, you know, these are emotions, of course, that all of us experience, especially when things in our lives are not going that well. And if you're like me, and I'm sure you are, I don't think we're all together that much different, often rather than bring these doubts and bring these fears to God and, you know, being honest with God about them and then trusting him and finding peace in his promises, rather than doing that, we tend to let them control us and overwhelm us and dictate our decisions and the actions that we make. You know, and, you know, truth is, I do that an awful lot. And when I get into those kind of moments where I'm not trusting and I'm doubting, and maybe there's even, you know, a shred of despair in there, I'll challenge myself and I'll say, you know, why don't I trust God? Like, is my God not big enough for this issue that I'm facing? Is he not powerful enough? Is God not gracious enough? Is he not faithful? See, I think we all do this, and so what I'd like to do is I'd like to just take a few moments here this morning to just kind of prepare ourselves for the message by being honest with God, to confess to him our struggles to trust him and to believe in his promises. And so let me lead you in this prayer of confession. Wondrous God, we confess that at times our doubts and our fears, they override our hope and faith. God, forgive us when we lose sight of the joy of your love and instead we fall into despair and gloom. God, lift our spirits and help us to remember the promise of a new life here and now, and not just the hope of a resurrection for the future. Help us to know that you are at work in the daily activities that we go through and the hard decisions that have to be made, especially, Lord, in the difficult times that you are there. God, we give you thanks for your Son, Jesus Christ, who continues to offer us new life and who continues to turn us around and upside down and who continues to break down the walls of death in our own life. God, forgive us and restore us and renew us. In the name of our risen Savior, Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. Now, I want you to know that the Lord is merciful and gracious. The Bible says he's merciful and gracious, and he's slow to anger, and he's abounding in steadfast love. It says that he will not always accuse, nor will he keep his anger forever. He does not deal with us according to our sins, nor repay us according to our iniquities. For as high as the heavens are above the earth, so great is the steadfast love of God towards those who fear him. As far as the east is from the west, so far does he remove our sins and our transgressions from us. As a father has compassion on his children, so the Lord has compassion on those who fear him. And so in response to God's incredible faithfulness, I urge all of you here this morning to trust in the Lord with all your heart, and lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways, acknowledge him, and he will make your path straight. At this time, we have a children's message.
Boys and girls, I know the end of this week we have Halloween, and many of you have a lot of fun with Halloween. But in the church calendar, we also have a very important date, and that's Reformation Day. And Reformation Day comes about 500 years ago, that is when it was started. I think we have some slides. 500 years ago, there was a man named Martin Luther. And Martin Luther was a priest in the church. He was very aware of all of his sins. And boys and girls, he looked at himself and he said, I'm not good enough. And he tried and he tried to do everything right to make God happy. And he thought, if I'm just good enough, if I do all the good things, God will love me. And you know what? No matter what he did, he didn't feel like he had a good connection with God. He didn't feel like God really loved him. He thought, I just can't measure up to what I want God to do. And Martin Luther did a lot of studying in the Bible. And one time it just really struck him. I don't have to be good enough for God. God loves me no matter what. He just loves me. And boys and girls, that was a very important thing for him to learn, for him to realize. It's not because he's so good and he's going to be perfect that God wants him to live in heaven or to take him to heaven with him. He just loves him. And so Martin Luther saw a lot of things that were going wrong in the church. And one of them was that they were teaching that you can earn your way and do good things to go to heaven. Another thing was that you can't have a real connection with God by yourself. You have to go through the priest or the minister in church. Martin saw those things that were wrong in the church, and he thought, I've got to get people thinking about it. So the picture we have is a picture of him drawing posting the things on the church wall, on the church door. He knew people were coming to church the next day. And he thought, I'm going to make sure people know about this and are thinking about this. And he had 95 things that he wrote down. I think it's 95. Yeah. 95 things that he wrote down that he said, these things need to change. Well, you can imagine what an uproar there was in the church. And it started a real change in the church called the Reformation. And it means people could think instead of lives of faith, instead of living in lives of fear. Now, one thing that he had made was he had made a symbol for himself, and it was on a ring, and it's called the Luther Rose. And the Luther Rose, he explained to somebody that he was writing to, he says, okay, the middle of it is the cross. That's the very center of his life. The reminder that faith in Jesus died for our sins, is the very center of it. Around that is a heart. We will only be saved if we believe with our whole heart. That's what God wants from us, to believe with our whole heart. And though the cross is set in the heart, it doesn't kill the heart. It preserves it instead with life. Around that is a white stylized rose. It doesn't look so much like a rose like you might see in your garden, but it's a rose. And that is to symbolize joy and peace and comfort. And white being the symbol of the color of the angels, or that's what he was thinking of, angels and spirits with the color of white. Around that is a set of blue, faith, representing faith is the beginning of the heavenly joys to come. And around that is a ring of gold. Gold is very precious. It was then and it still is now. Heaven is even more precious, and it goes on forever and ever. That's why it has the ring shape. Heaven is even more precious than gold. Now, people at home, you had a link in your order of worship, and people in church, you have a copy of that page that the boys and girls can use to color if they would like. It's at the back of the church if you brought your crayons. Just as a reminder of what Luther stands for and the importance that he had in the church, the history of the church. I've read this verse twice already, and I'm going to read it a third time. It's the verse that's at the bottom of the poster that I just showed you. For it is by grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not from yourselves, it is the gift from God. Not by works, so that no one else can boast. No one can boast. From Ephesians 2, verse 8. The message Martin came to, the message he wants to leave with us, it's not by all the good things we do. It's by faith, by God's grace, that we are his children. Let's pray. Lord, your word is so full and so rich and has meaning for our lives in all times. And we thank you for it. We thank you for the words and the reminders that Martin Luther gave the church at that time to start a whole reformation, a change in the church. We thank you for that promise that you give to us. It is by grace, not by what we do. We are not perfect. We are not going to earn our way to heaven, but we thank you for your grace that you have given to us. In your name we pray, amen. Now we're going to sing.
Let's bow our heads in prayer. Lord and God, again, we come before you this morning, and Lord, we pray at this point for a unique anointing by your Spirit, Lord, that the same Spirit that inspired these writers so many years ago will inspire our hearts and minds today to understand your word to us, Lord, as we read it from the Psalms, and Lord, as we look at a passage in Genesis as well, too. Lord, I pray, Lord, that we'll be inspired by your Spirit to understand you better, our relationship with you better, Lord, and how to process, you know, another one of the emotions that we often have to struggle and deal with in life. And so, Lord, I pray that that you will just bless the reading of your word and the message given this morning as well. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. So I'm going to read from Psalm 3, verses 1 through 8, and then I'm going to move over to Genesis 15, and I'll read about 10 verses there. So Psalm 3. It's a psalm of David. O Lord, how many are my foes? How many rise up against me? Many are saying of me, God will not deliver him. But God, you are a shield around me, O Lord. You bestow glory on me and lift up my head. To the Lord I cry aloud, and he answers me from his holy hill. I lie down and I sleep, and I wake again because the Lord sustains me. And I will not fear the tens of thousands drawn up against me on every side. So arise, O Lord, deliver me, O my God. Strike all my enemies on the jaw, break the teeth of the wicked. From the Lord comes deliverance. May your blessing be on your people. And then from Genesis 15, I'm going to read verses 1 through 10. God's covenant with Abram. After this, the word of the Lord came to Abram in a vision. Do not be afraid, Abram. I am your shield and your very great reward. But Abram said, O sovereign Lord, what can you give me, since I remain childless, and the one who will inherit my estate is Eliezer of Damascus? And Abram said, You have given me no children, so a servant in my household will be my heir. Then the word of the Lord came to him, This man will not be your heir, but a son coming from your own body will be your heir. He took him outside and said, Look up at the heavens and count the stars, if indeed you can count them. Then he said to him, So shall your offspring be. Abram believed the Lord, and he credited it to him as righteousness. And he also said to him, I am the Lord who brought you out of Ur of the Chaldeans to give you this land to take possession of it. But Abraham said, O sovereign Lord, how can I know that I will gain possession of it? So the Lord said to him, Bring me a heifer, a goat, and a ram, each 3 years old, along with a dove and a young pigeon. Abram brought all these to him, cut them in two, and arranged the halves opposite each other. The birds, however, he did not cut in half. And I'll just read verse 11. The birds of prey came down on the carcasses, but Abram drove them away. This is God's word to us this morning. So in the times that I've been with you, we've been talking about the Psalms. We've been looking at different Psalms. And one of the things I've mentioned to you is that the Psalms are just an amazing gift. And I'm sure you've discovered that. Hopefully you've discovered that in your time reading the Bible and you're walking your journey with God. Like, the Psalms are an amazing gift to us because the Psalms tend to focus on emotions, right? On the sort of deep inner feelings and processes of the human heart. And what we find in the Psalms is essentially, and I've mentioned this a couple times, right? Like, essentially this biblical way to deal with, to kind of process our feelings. And it's so important that we have that because, you know, often when it comes to emotions, we have a tendency to feel a little bit uncomfortable with them because on the one hand, you know, we believe that, you know, we were created with emotions, right? God created the world. God created us with emotions. And when God finished creating the world, he said it was good. Right? So God wants us to feel. Emotions are good. And so we feel. That's great. But then on the other hand, maybe we've been taught at different points in our lives, or maybe people have come into our lives and kind of challenged us in different ways, that we need to kind of, in some sense, avoid emotions, right? We got to rise above them. We've got to be logical and rational. And don't let those things dictate your life. So we've kind of got these two kind of opposing positions, I guess, and the result often is confusion. Don't really know what to do with my emotions. And that's where the Psalms come in, because what the Psalms do is they provide us with a very sort of uniquely biblical way to deal with our feelings. And the Psalms are fascinating because on the one hand, they're not sort of this rational, you know, detached intellectual discussion about feelings, okay? It's not like we got a whole bunch of philosophers who got together to talk about feelings or scientists and say, well, this is where it comes from. So it's not that. But then on the other hand, it's not simply, you know, expressions of feelings, like people just like pouring them out. Out comes the anger, out comes the fear. It's not that either. The psalmists are neither discussing feelings nor are they simply expressing them. Rather, what they do in the psalms is they pray them. They pray them out before God. The psalmists are processing their feelings in the presence of God through prayer. And so from the Psalms, we can learn a lot about how to deal with our deep feelings from a biblical perspective before God. Now, we've looked at a few different ones up to this point, doubt and guilt. And what we're going to do this morning is we're going to look at another one that I think is really prevalent. And I've had conversations with you before about this emotion, but we're going to look at this in a little bit more deeper way this morning. We're going to look at the emotion of fear. Now, if you go back to the beginning of Psalm 3, if you have your Bible open, if you have your own Bible open, that's cool. Go back to the beginning of Psalm 3. If not, just listen to this. We know at the beginning of Psalm 3, it's pretty clear that David is afraid. Okay, David is afraid. And, you know, here's the thing. He's got a good reason to be afraid, okay? He's got literally armies of people trying to kill him. You know, like we always use that phrase, oh man, this is killing me. Okay, you know, we use that figuratively, right? But no, this is literal. This is literal. He's got armies of people who are trying to kill him. And yet, here's the thing. What's so amazing is that in the midst of this happening, okay, in the midst of this impending threat to his life, David in verse 6 says this. He says, I will not fear. I will not fear. In fact, not only will I not fear, but I love this. This is what he says. He says, I lie down and I sleep and I wake again, even though tens of thousands are amassing against me. So David obviously found a way to deal with his fear. I don't have thousands of people literally trying to kill me, and I have trouble sleeping at night sometimes. I don't know about you. Maybe you've got that issue, okay? David obviously found a way to deal with his fear. In Psalm 3, David prays his fears before God, and in doing so, he finds a way to deal with and to overcome the fear that he's experienced in his life. And so what we're going to do using Psalm 3 is we're going to focus on this emotion of fear and how to handle this from a biblical perspective. Now, one of the things that we learn from this passage is that there are really two kind of levels of fear. In verse 1 and 2, David says this. He says, O Lord, how many are my foes? How many rise up against me? Many are saying of me, God will not deliver him. Okay, so a little bit of context. When David spoke these words, his son Absalom, maybe you know this story, kind of remember it. His son Absalom was leading a rebellion, like a coup against him. So Absalom had actually declared himself king, aligned himself with a few people, declared himself king, and David had run off into the wilderness, fleeing for his life with this army, literally chasing right after him, okay? So in verse 1, when he says, hey, God, how many are my foes? How many rise up against me? He's speaking about a very legitimate physical fear, okay? He's being attacked, and he's afraid for his life. That is one kind of fear. That is one kind of fear. Now, the fear that gets expressed in verse 2 here, it's a little bit different than the one earlier. This is what it says. It says, many are saying of me, God will not deliver him. If you go back to 2 Samuel, there's a story there about a fellow named King Saul, okay? King Saul, first king of Israel. And in that story, you know, just give you a really short snippet here. It says, in that story, it says that God abandoned Saul. God abandoned him because he had sinned. Okay, he committed a sin. He didn't follow God's instructions, and he went and did it by himself, and God abandoned him. God walked away from that. So God took the kingship away from Saul. Okay, God abandoned him. And if you think about that terminology, right, God had abandoned him, this is now also what they're saying is happening to David. Okay, so because of his sins, at least that's their rationale, right? Because why else would God abandon you? In that time period, if God wasn't for you, then it was obviously because you had done something wrong. You had made a mistake. You had sinned. Or if things weren't going well in your life, it was particularly because you had sinned and made a mistake. It couldn't be because maybe God was orchestrating something different. Okay, so they have this in their mind that because of his sins, he's no longer fit to be king. Like, you wouldn't have a rebellion from your son if you had not sinned, okay? So maybe he's not fit to be king. He's committed a sin somewhere, and so God's taking the kingship away from him. And so David is not just being attacked physically. That's happening, but not just that. You got to understand, on the other side, it's also his identity. It's his character that is being called into question. His character as a person is being attacked. Now, in the middle of the, it's interesting, in the middle of the 20th century, there was a lot of study done by different philosophers and psychiatrists on this emotion of fear. And at the time, they made a distinction between two things. They made a distinction between fear and anxiety. Now, in most literature, including the Bible, those words tend to be used interchangeably. But the distinction, actually, I think, is actually pretty important, because what they tend to highlight is that there are really two different levels of fear. Okay, so the psychiatrist and the psychologist would say, we have one that we're calling simply fear, and then the other one we're going to call anxiety. Now, If after church you walk out to the road there, right, and you see a car speeding toward you, your heart suddenly beats a little bit faster, you're crossing the road, you quickly calculate the distance between that car and you, and it's coming a little bit quicker than you anticipated, you start to run, right? You run across the road. That's fear. Okay, you don't want to get hit, you don't want to get killed by the car, but that's a healthy kind of fear, okay? So what happens in that moment is you identify something good. That's you. You're good, okay? You are something good. That's being threatened by this several-ton vehicle hurtling at you, and fear helps you to summon all your deepest capacities to get out of the way. Do something about the problem. But then there's a deeper, sort of unhealthy, debilitating kind of fear. So, you know, for example, let's say after, you know, you're newly married, you get married, you're always checking up on your spouse. And you're kind of sneaky, you kind of read their emails, you check their phone records, and you're asking them probing and leading questions because you always just believe that you can't trust them, right? That they're not trustworthy. That is an unhealthy kind of fear. That is the kind of fear that they would refer to as anxiety. And unlike the healthy fear, it's not really specific. Okay, you don't know exactly why you feel that way, why you can't trust, or what's causing it. You just do it. And unlike fear, rather than move you to action, what it tends to do is it tends to debilitate you, it tends to paralyze you and hold you hostage. So the question is, well, what ultimately causes that kind of fear, right? Like, what causes that kind of anxiety? Well, psychologist Ronald May says anxiety results when your fear, or when you feel that your sense of self is being threatened, okay? So anxiety results when you feel that your sense of self is being threatened. So in other words, anxiety comes when something that you have put your security in, something that has made you feel in control, feel like you had an identity, your sense of self is being threatened. Now, I don't think Ronald May knew this, but when I listen to what he says, you got to understand, there's spiritual roots to this, right? Now, David has got both kinds of fear. He's not just being attacked physically, but his identity is under attack. His character as a person is being under attack. His own sense of who he is being attacked. So what does he do about it? He's experiencing not just fear, but anxiety. So what does he do? Well, he does three things. That I want to kind of focus on as we go along this morning. And the three things he does is he follows God forward. Okay, he relocates his glory, and then he sees the substitute. Okay, so that's where we're going to head. First, follow God forward. In verse 3, David said of God, he said, "You are a shield around me." In the ancient world, basically there's two types of shield. You've probably seen this in movies, right? There was that shield that you would have on your arm for hand-to-hand combat, right? So you got the loops on your arm, you got a sword in the other, hand-to-hand combat. And then there was, you've probably seen this in more of like Roman Empire sort of movies. There was this much larger shield, about the size of a door, that was curved. So it's slightly wrapped around you. Now that larger shield, you think about the, you know, the practical application, the larger shield was obviously not really good for hand-to-hand combat, right? It's the size of a door, you're carrying around a door. It's not great for hand-to-hand. So rather, you would use a shield like that when an army was attacking a fortress. Okay, so think about that. This is not a shield that gets you away from danger, so to speak, right? This is a shield that you use to go towards the danger. And so when David says, "I'm scared, God. God, I'm scared, but you are a shield around me," he's imagining that kind of larger shield. And what he's acknowledging is that God, in that sense, is like the general who's taking him forward into the unknown, so to speak, into the danger. Okay? And he's not saying that God's going to keep him from danger and pain. He's not saying that, but rather that God, in that sense, is actually the one leading him into it, and that his protection, this shield, only is going to work if he continues to follow God, if he obeys him. If he turns and runs back, then the shield is gone. The shield is not going to help him anymore. Okay, so it's only by following him forward, by going with God, that he's going to be protected by him. But again, not in such a way that he's never going to experience pain and danger, but in such a way that no matter how bad things get, God will somehow work it out for his good. And see, that right there, that's what it means to be shielded by God, that God uses and even allows bad things into our life for a greater good, to shield and to protect you, right? Like, think about that. And I know it's hard to wrap our heads around that, but to think that God might use our hurt today to save you from a much greater harm tomorrow. And so the point is, it's into, so to speak, the unknown, into that danger that God's protection works. It's by obeying him, even if you don't understand why he's doing what he's doing, even if you don't like it, it's by obeying him that you'll be able to experience his protection. But if you don't trust him, and if you run away from him, then he cannot shield you anymore. And ultimately, if you run away from that shield and you're out there on your own, that's lethal. See, you have to remember that at one point in time, Jesus himself was also very scared. Right? Like Jesus was in the garden and he sweat in the garden. Why? Because he was frightened and he was scared. And why? Because the will of his Father, right? The will of God was taking Jesus right to the cross and right to the tomb. And he knew that. And here's the thing, over and over again, that's going to happen to us, right? To obey God at some points in time, and maybe a lot of points in time, it's going to seem nuts. And maybe it doesn't seem nuts, but it seems hard. It seems really hard and painful and difficult. But as David clearly shows us, his protection only works when we obey him and we follow him and we keep moving forward with him, even if it takes us into places that we don't always really want to go. It's only by following him that we know that God will work out good in our lives. If we back out and if we go another direction and we just go our own way and do things on our own, well, you know, truth is then we really have something to be scared of. Okay, so the first step is to follow God forward. The second step is to relocate your glory. Verse 3, David says, "You bestow glory upon me and you lift up my head," which let's do a literal translation here would be, "You are my glory. God, you are my glory. You are the lifter of my head." Now, I think I've said this to you before, but glory essentially means weight, Okay, it means weight or significance. So God was the one, this is what David's saying, God was the one on whom David rested his weight, his significance. Okay, he was his source of significance. But David realized, you got to realize that David wouldn't be saying that here. That, like, he wouldn't say, hey, God, you are my glory, unless something else maybe had been his glory before. See, David had experienced anxiety, right? We were talked about that. David experienced anxiety, this deeper level of fear, because he had, in the past, built his identity on the things that made him feel secure and on different things that had now been taken away. So the reason before David felt secure and good in life was because he was the king, right? And he had the approval of his people. People loved him, right? You know, he would come in, he would conquer, and we would sing and dance. He had a loving family. And all of those are good things. They're really good things. But he had located his sense of significance, his weight, his glory, his security, his identity in those things. And when you do that, that's a bad thing. See, anxiety results when you've located your glory in something good. Okay, I'm not saying it's bad stuff, right? Like, I'm not saying, you know, you're locating your glory in bad stuff. Most of us aren't, right? We're not directly 100% disobeying, don't murder, and, you know, like, we're not saying, oh, we find our glory and our weight and those kind of things. Obviously, we're not doing that. So we're talking good things, but anxiety results when you've located your glory in something good. So maybe it's a talent you have. Maybe it's your spouse. Maybe it's your children, and all of those are amazing, wonderful, good things, but if you locate your glory in them, then what you've done is you've put your sense of self-worth in security in something that is finite. You understand what I mean, right? Finite. Finite things are vulnerable. They can be taken away. Okay, they can go away. And therefore, if you've put your security and hope and everything in those things, you will always live in fear. You will always live in fear. What happens if? Right? What happens if I lose my job? What happens if my spouse goes? Or if my children? What happens if? David realized that. He examined his heart, and he saw that he was anxious because he had located his glory in finite things that had actually now been taken away from him, right? He didn't have the loving family. Like, I can't consider a son that leads a coup against you a loving son. Okay, he's lost the kingship at the moment. He doesn't have that. He's on the run. He doesn't have his palace. Right? So David has lost all of that kind of stuff. Okay? And so you got to understand that anxiety is just a symptom of a much larger problem. And if you trace it back, you'll find that the problem is that something has become far too important to you. And the only way to rid yourself of that kind of anxiety is to relocate your glory. And that's what David does. David says, "You, God, are my glory." So he says, it's not their approval, but it's your approval, God, that I really care about. It's not serving them, it's serving you that's most important. It's not their love, God, it's your love that matters the most. And I have that. I have it. And that's guaranteed. And so I'm not going to make my family, I'm not going to make my kingship, and I'm not going to make the approval of all of my people in this kingdom my identity anymore. Your approval, your love, that's all I need. You are the one, God, and I said it, God, you are the one who lifts up my head, and so I am not going to be anxious. Am I afraid of this big army coming at me? Yeah, physically, right? Like, the car is coming at me. I don't want to get hit. I don't want to die. But am I anxious? Nah. And so the second step is to relocate your glory. The third step is to see the substitute. Because, like, how does David know that he has God's approval, right, and love? Like, he says that, like, he says, I know you are the one who lifts up my head. I know that. I got that. How does he know that, though, exactly? How does he know that even though, like, if we want to look at David's life, right, we've got a moment of honesty here, right? How do we know that even though he's killed somebody, right? Committed adultery, failed as a father, a king, and a believer. How does he know, despite all of these things? Because, you know, David did some pretty nasty stuff in his life. How do we know that God, how did he know that God forgave him? How does he know that God loves him and that God approves of him? How does he know that? And see, that right there is the key, because if you knew, despite anything that you did, that God still loved you and approved of you, if that was in your heart, if that was the heart of your identity, then really, let's be honest, nothing really could bother you. Nothing really could scare you to death, because you're only scared to death to the degree that you've placed your glory in something that actually can die, right? Something finite. So how does David know this? Well, in verse 4, he says, I cry aloud, and he answers me from his holy hill. Now, that reference to holy hill is a reference to Mount Moriah, to the tabernacle, to the place where sins were atoned for, right? Sacrifices were made and sins were atoned for. So the question then is, what is David just thinking about, you know, the altar, the temple, and that God is somehow dealing with his sins through sacrifices on the altar? Maybe. I think that's very possible. But I think there's also something deeper going on here. See, I think David was also thinking about an event that happened back in Genesis 15 that he would have known about for sure. And the reason why I say this is because the words that we find in Psalm 3 also show up at the beginning of Genesis 15. We're talking the same language. So in Genesis 15, Abraham is scared, and God comes to him and says, hey, Abraham, don't be afraid. I am your shield. And your great reward. Now, it's really hard to believe that David, who would have known Genesis 15 for sure, was not thinking about that. Because here's David trying to deal with his own fear and anxiety in exactly the same way that God had addressed Abraham's back in Genesis. So what happened in Genesis? You know, like, what's David thinking about here? Well, in Genesis 15, God says to Abraham, says, Abraham, I am your shield and I am your glory. And Abraham said, that sounds cool, God, but how do I know? How do I know? And how, like, give me some proof. And in response, God says to Abraham, he says, okay, Abraham, take a bunch of animals and then cut them into pieces. It sounds kind of weird, but let me explain it. The way you made a contract or a vow back in those days was not by signing a piece of paper like we do today, right? Rather, what you would do is you would take these animals, you would cut up the animals, you would put them on either side, create this path through the middle, and then you'd walk between the pieces as you made your vow or as you made your promise. And what that meant was that you were identifying with the animal. Okay, you were identifying with the animal and you were acting out the curse of breaking the covenant. So you were saying, look, if I don't do all the things that I'm promising right now as I'm going through these pieces, may I be like these animals on either side, okay? May I be cut into pieces. So when God told Abraham to cut up the animals, Abraham knew this, okay? Like, this wasn't a shock to him. He's like, yeah, okay, we're cool. We're going to make some promises here. So he figured, you know, God was going to make some promises, and he figured he was going to walk through and he was going to make some promises, because that's how the contract works. But the story goes on and it tells us, and we didn't get to that point, I just encourage you, if you haven't read it before, read it when you get home. That evening or that night, manifestations of God come and they pass through the pieces, and God makes amazing promises. But Abraham never walks through the pieces, never walks through it. So God makes this oath, beautiful. He promises to bless Abraham. Abraham doesn't promise anything in return. So what does that mean? Well, he promises to bless Abraham regardless of what Abraham does. Even if Abraham disobeys, even if Abraham fails, even if Abraham makes terrible mistakes, God was going to be faithful to him. God was going to bless him. David knew that story. For sure he knew that story. And that's how David also knew that he was forgiven and that he was loved and approved by God. And yet, here's the thing. There's something that David didn't know that you and I know. And what we know is how God actually accomplished that. How God did that. And how did God do that? Well, centuries later, God cut off his son. See, Jesus was cut off from the land of the living. He was cut off from his father. God cut him off. And that's how you and I know that he, in fact, ultimately loves us and approves of us and values us. And to the degree that that becomes your glory and that becomes your sense of value and that becomes your sense of worth and security, to that degree that that becomes the thing that you stand, that you put your weight upon, you will be impervious to the debilitating kind of anxiety that we've been talking about. Because in 1 John 4, it says this. It says, there is no fear in love. But perfect love, the perfect love of God, drives out fear. The one who fears is not made perfect in love. And there is no more perfect love than that demonstrated by Jesus on the cross for you. And if you take that into the center of your being, you dwell on it, you pray for it, you read about it, you spend time immersing yourself in the beauty of that. You take that into the center of your being. If that becomes your glory, and to the degree that it does, you are going to be able to deal with those debilitating types of fear and anxiety that really hold a lot of us hostage. You know, brothers and sisters, Jesus sweat in the garden because he was scared. But he didn't let that stop him. He trusted his father. He trusted his father. He followed his father forward to the cross and to the grave. And guess what? It wasn't a dead end. It wasn't. There was a resurrection. This is amazing. There was a resurrection on the other side of that grave. And I want you to know that there will be a resurrection on the other side of anything that you fear, that you are brought into and that you go into with God. There will always be a resurrection. If you are afraid, follow God through. Trust him. Relocate your glory. Look to the substitute, and God will heal you through your fears. And God will heal you of your fears. Amen. Let's pray. Our Lord and God, we thank you so much for the Psalms, Lord, how they speak to us of your truth and the power and the majesty and the beauty of who you are, and particularly of your faithfulness. God, there's no greater expression of love that one would lay down their life for the sake of another. And God, you know, we read these stories about David and Abraham and cutting up pieces and breaking vows. And God, we know that the way that you were able to keep your promise was by cutting off your son. And yet your son, Jesus, thank you that you did that willingly, that you trusted in your father, that this was the way forward. This was the way to save your people, the ones that you love. And I can only imagine what may have been in Jesus' head at that moment in the garden, looking at what was coming in front of him. Who in their right mind would ever want to go through that? And yet he trusted in his father enough to follow that forward and to go to the cross and to the grave. And on the other side was a resurrection. The saving of all mankind. God, I thank you for that, Lord. And I pray that in our moment of challenges and fears and anxieties, when we're tempted to run away from you, God, I pray that we will remember. Well, that we will remember that your protection works when we trust you and we follow you forward, and that you are indeed trustworthy. And in those moments where we struggle to believe, where it might feel just better if we run and we hide ourselves in a hole somewhere, God, I pray that we will remember your son, Jesus Christ. But then when we need that proof of your trustworthiness and your love and your grace to us and working out good out of the most messy of situations, may we look to your son, Jesus Christ, and believe in our hearts that there will be a resurrection for us too on the other side. God, thank you for David, for his story and for his challenge. Lord, and I pray that we'll be able to process out our fears and our anxieties before you and find freedom from them in your holy and precious name. Amen. Let's stand. Let's sing a hymn of response. The battle belongs to the Lord.
Let's come together in congregational prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we come to you this morning as a body of believers and thank you that we can worship you freely here together. We praise you for always listening when we talk or cry out to you, for giving us guidance as we navigate through life, for giving us a purpose here in this world, and for constantly extending your amazing grace to us each day. At this point in time, some of us are in a season of joy and celebration, some of us are in a season of pain and suffering, and some of us are in a season of uncertainty or indifference. Lord, whatever our season or situation is, we thank you for always loving us unconditionally and for constantly surrounding us with your gracious and gentle presence. We are blessed to be a part of a community where we can share in each other's joys and in our burdens. And at this time, we thank you that Case Annan and Herman Larman were able to return home from the hospital and pray for continued recovery for each of them. We pray for Ron Flick as he is still in continuing care, Herm Siemens as he continues with immunotherapy treatments, and Margaret Bramer in Bonnie Place. We also pray for Tyler Kasher and his family as he continues his battle with cancer. Lord, in all of their situations, we pray that they will feel immense support from all of those surrounding them, and most importantly, from you, the ultimate comforter, provider, and peace giver. We continue to pray for Bernie and the rest of the Helder family, along with all those mourning the loss of loved ones, and pray for strength and comfort for each of them as well. We thank you for the many opportunities to share your love and goodness with those around us. With the World Hunger Campaign happening in a week, we are reminded again of how many brothers and sisters in Christ suffer around the world. There are various causes of hunger, but the bottom line is no one should ever have to go without a meal or fresh water to drink. We thank you for encouraging people to take action and help these people in need, and pray that you will continue to do so at large and also here in our church. We thank you for giving us an opportunity to help next week. We pray, too, for the Church Renewal Lab starting tomorrow as we go through the Book of Acts. This is a great way to not only grow in our faith individually, but also as a church community. We look forward to this experience and pray that you'll encourage us to participate in it. We pray for the schools and also for our various church groups and programs running at this time. Even though there are regulations in place and things look a lot different this year, we trust that many will be blessed by the efforts of teachers, staff, and volunteers. We extend a lot of gratitude to Pastor Bosma and Teresa as their workloads have increased and they carry on with their many daily tasks. We are also super thankful for Rose and our youth leaders as they engage with and get to know the youth. We also thank you for the tech and sound people, musicians, committee members, volunteers in various regards, custodians, the list goes on. We have a lot of people investing a lot of time, care, and effort into our church, and we pray that they will feel appreciated and that you will continue to bless them in their efforts. We lift up to you the Pastor Search Committee as they continue their work behind the scenes. We pray for patience and wisdom as they keep searching. May they be encouraged by the fact that you can see the big picture and that we will find a pastor in time. We acknowledge that as humans we are broken. We all have our own shortcomings and faults. We all make mistakes and mess up sometimes. It can be so easy to get caught up in guilt and shame, which is why we need a constant reminder of your undeserving and overwhelming grace that you pour over us each day. In light of today being Reformation Sunday, we are reminded of the beautiful truth that you are always showering us with mercy, as it is written in the Word. It is not by our works that we are saved, but because of your love for us, which we accept and embrace as your children. There is nothing in this world and nothing we can do that can separate us from your love. We know that you are to be at the center of our schools, our jobs, our church, and our everyday lives. We pray for opportunities to share this truth of your amazing grace with those around us. The world needs you, and we ask that you shine your light through us. We celebrate with everyone that has a birthday this week. Romy Korovar, Dina Sternberg, Leslie Vandenbrink, Lori Kielstra, Jim Hutke, Aaron Castra, Rosie Ahrens, Anna Lapidat, Haley Provost, and Brad Provost. We pray that each will feel special and loved as they celebrate. Please bless our offerings for the budget and denominational ministry shares, and also for the Resonant Global Mission. Thank you for hearing our prayers. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Hunger for many things. But this year, with the onset of a pandemic, many of us have hungered for something far more essential. 1 billion people around the world are facing the struggle to access food. Amidst COVID-19, families experiencing hunger and poverty have been driven into even deeper suffering. Jobs have been lost, markets closed, and crops failed, sending communities to face unlivable situations. But the pandemic hasn't just changed their stories. It's changed yours too. Maybe you have lost a loved one, or your job, or maybe even some hope. maybe you too feel empty, afraid, or unsure. And to you, Jesus says, come to the table with what feels full or empty, for I am the bread of life. Jesus' love is needed now more than ever. Our world is hungering to heal and thrive. And there is hope, because at the table of God, there is enough. And when we share that table, every table gets its share of food. What you share with World Renew today helps ensure there is enough love, enough hope, and yes, enough food for tables around the world.
I'll ask you to rise for God's parting blessing. So as we head out from here this morning, go in peace in the knowledge of God's power. Go in confidence in the knowledge of God's strength. Go in joy in the knowledge of God's incredible love for you. And as you go, may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you all. And together we say, amen. Sing our closing song.